life on the New York streets. But during the last decade, Reed has cleaned up his act and has, according to him, discovered a new pleasure in the art of making records. His new album, Magic and Loss, deals with his reactions to the death from cancer of two close friends. The subject matter might sound gloomy, but Magic and Loss reveals a Reed who finally seems to have found something to believe in. We visited Lou Reed rehearsing for his new British tour and filmed an exclusive performance of songs and lyrics from Magic and Loss. But first, he talked to The Late Show's Mark Cooper.
The subject matter of Magic and Loss, death and bereavement and grief and a kind of recovery from it, is different from your earlier work in as much as that a lot of your previous songs have been seen as very fatalistic, but there's a kind of transcendence in this record, isn't there? That is.
Well, I never thought of my other stuff as fatalistic as opposed to realistic urban reality, devoid of any kind of moral stance about it, just reportage of a lot of it. But Magic and Loss, about loss, friendship. I think of it a lot as being a lot about friendship and love and inspiration and people's spirits and how you deal with the loss. I know Andy Warhol said in one of his philosophy books that maybe they should teach love in school. They don't teach very much very well, but so I'm not sure I agree with that. But I thought, well, if you're going to teach love, you should also teach loss.
Do you think you could have written Magic and Loss, the idea of something positive attained from loss, before, or is it something that your own recent experience taught you to be able to write?
I don't think I could have dealt with Magic and Loss until the time that I did. I wouldn't have been capable of writing it. It's one of the great themes, death, for writers. And I think you need a certain, or I do, a certain maturity to approach it. It's a difficult subject. You don't want to be sentimental. And I think you also need some experience with life to be able to approach it with the respect that's due it.
Do you think there's any subject that you can't write about in rock and roll? Do you think rock and roll for you has no limits?
Rock and roll for me has no limits, for sure. I mean, that's one of my points about it. I mean, I'm a person who I always played in bar bands, really liked rock and roll, including when I was in college, got a BA in English. But as you get older, you would still like to listen to rock and roll. It becomes very difficult. It's so much of it is really oriented towards younger kids. Or 14-year-old males, you know, if you read what the demographics are. What about the rest of us who still really like rock and roll? It'd be nice to be able to go listen to a rock and roll record and have it be on the level of a novel and still have the fun of the rock and roll. Because I love the two guitars, bass, drum.
From the start, has it been part of what you were concerned with, to challenge that notion that rock and roll could only deal with adolescent subjects?
Well, I didn't want to challenge it because there was nothing to challenge. It's obvious it can. And it never has crossed my mind that you can't. It just seems such an obvious thing to do.
Part of the way that you've challenged it is by gradually refusing to necessarily become the person in the songs. You have some distance between the characters in these songs and yourself. Is that hard to get over to people? Do they always expect you to be the person in the songs?
Well, I think for a couple of years there, I made it hard on myself, you know, because I was having fun being what some of the stuff was, but writing about it and being it are really two entirely different things, and I don't think you'd necessarily accuse a novelist of it, but of course a novelist doesn't have a rock and roll show he's performing in either. But you have to have some distance from it. You have to have some distance from it, or else you have no judgment about it.
What made you more focused, as you say, if you feel for a couple of years you got lost or confused there between writing and being the performer, what made you decide to get focused?
Oh, the work. When it doesn't come
because
out...
Because it was suffering or because you felt
well,
it could be
better? Well, because it wasn't coming out the way I wanted. And it's obvious why it wasn't coming out the way I would want it. I was having a lot of problems in a lot of different areas, but all of those areas could be coped with if I was sober. So that's what I did.
The compassion for these characters, do you think that's something that, in a sense, the characters need? Because in a lot of your songs, they're people who are the passed over.
I think not everybody has a... not everybody gets a chance in life. That's fair. I think not everybody grows up in a loving household with these wonderful parents and money and great opportunities, or just happy childhood and happy situations. And what about those people? And the extension of what happens to people in life. I don't think there's anything that I'm writing about that isn't a universal to most people. And I'm writing for the people who didn't have an idyllic start.
Or an idyllic end, because in Magic and Loss, you seem to be writing particularly for two
friends. Well, I don't think anybody really has an idyllic end. I mean, my two friends had great, great lives, and they live on through the spirit of their friends as we speak. They had great, great lives. It's just a shame they couldn't be longer, but their lives are really spectacular, in my opinion.
You feel that there have been any inexplicable transformations in your life in becoming what you've become now, say, compared with what you were 10 years ago?
Well, it's inexplicable how I managed to live to even be here today on your TV show, but since that's what happened, good luck for me.
Becoming, but life's forever dealing in hurt now. Life's death without living, that's what life's like without you. Life's like Sanskrit read to a pony. I see you in my mind's eye, strangling on your tongue. What good is knowing such devotion? I've been around, I know what makes things run. What good is seeing our chocolate? What good's a computerized nose? And what good was cancer in April? Why no good, baby? No good at all. What good is war without killing? What good is rain that falls up? What good's a disease that won't hurt you, baby? No good, I guess. No good at all. What good are these thoughts that I'm thinking? It must be better not to be thinking at all. A styrofoam lover with emotions of concrete. No, not much. Not much at all. What good? Is life without living? What good's this lion that barks? You loved a life others throw away nightly. It's not fair. It's not fair at all. What's good? What's good? What's good? What's good? Not much at all. Yeah, come on, baby, tell me what's good. What's good? What's good? Not much at all. What's good? Life's good. Life's good. Life's good, but not fair at all.
I saw a great man turn into a little child, the cancer reduce him to dust, his voice growing weak as he fought for his life with a bravery few men know. I saw isotopes introduced into his lungs, trying to stop the cancerous spread, and it made me think of Lita and the swan, and gold being made from lead. The same power that burned Hiroshima, causing three-legged babies and death shrunk to the size of a nickel to help him regain his breath. And I was struck by the power and the glory. I was visited by a majestic hymn. Great bolts of lightning lighting up the sky as the radiation flowed through him. He wanted all of it, not some of it.
Dog bark, I turn and say, what were you saying? I picture you in the red chair inside the pale room. Chair with a tube in your arm. You were so skinny. You were still making jokes. I don't know what drugs they had you on. You said, I guess this is not the time for long-term invest. You were always laughing, but you never laughed at me. They say in the end the pain was so bad that you were screaming. Now you were no saint, but you deserved way better than that. From the corner, I watched them removing things from your apartment. But I can picture your red chair and pale room inside my head. I close my eyes, I see your face, and I'm not without you. I try hard and concentrate, I can hear your voice saying, who better than you? If I close my eyes, I can't believe that I'm here without you. Inside your pale room, your empty red chair, and my head. Dreaming, is dreaming. Installed angels in every subject's house. The agents of my goodness, no one would be without. A steak on every plate, a car in every house. And if you ever cross me, I'd have your eyes put out. Without me, without me you don't exist. And if logic won't convince you, then there's always this. I'm bigger, smarter, stronger, tough, yes, sensitive and kind. And though I could crush you like a bug, it would never cross my mind. It wouldn't cross my mind to break your neck or rip out your vicious tongue. It wouldn't cross my mind to snap your leg like a twig or squash you like some slug. You are a violent messenger and I'm not above your taunts. You hit me, you know I'll kill you because I'm a warrior king. We'll be right back.
They say no one person can do it all, but you want to in your head. But you can't be Shakespeare and you can't be Joyce. So what is left instead? You're stuck with yourself in a rage that can hurt you. You have to start at the beginning again. And just this moment, this wonderful fire has started up again. When you pass through humble, when you pass through sickly, when you pass through I'm better than you all, when you pass through anger and self-deprecation and have the strength to acknowledge it all, when the past makes you laugh and you can savor the magic that let you survive your own war, you find that that fire is passion. And there's a door up ahead, not a wall. As you pass through fire, as you pass through fire, try to remember its name. When you pass through fire licking at your lips, you cannot remain the same. And if the building's burning, move towards that door, but don't put the flames out. There's a bit of magic in everything, and then some loss to even things out.
Lou Reed will start his British tour in March, and his book, Between Thought and Expression, a selection of lyrics from the past 25 years, has just been published. And that-